The city received the offer of a hot young Italian player. They dreamt of goals and glory, of stars like Zola and Viali. What opera is to music, the Italians are to football. Passionate, dramatic, with moments of dazzling genius. It's for moments like this that Italians in the ship are worshipped like gods.
For Banger to receive a promising youth international from Italy, not to put too fine a point on it, I think, you know, most clubs in the Welsh Premier would have bitten your arm off.
The offer came direct from the Italian Football Association. It was signed by an FA official, Matteo Colabassi.
What was on offer was a player on loan for the whole football season. It would cost the club absolutely nothing to take him. And at the end of the season, the Italian FA would pay them, I think it was €2,000. For a club like Banger, that was decent money.
The player was 21-year-old Alessandro Zarelli. The faxes described him as a brilliant left-footer who had already played for Sheffield Wednesday and Glasgow Rangers. Manager Peter Davenport, himself a former Manchester United player, knew the difference a footballer of this calibre could make to Bangor City.
This Alessandro Zarelli scored 14 goals in 42 games, according to the CV. It could mean the difference between us qualifying for European competition and not. The goals scored in midfield, they're few and far between.
The fans were definitely excited by the thought of having an Italian player on an exchange from the Italian FA coming to play for our club. You know, there's European football, if we get high enough in the league or we win one of the cups, and, you know, this guy might be the guy that tips the balance for us.
When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore.
Bangor City Football Club have a proud history, but like many clubs at this level, a run on a shoestring as a labour of love. When Bangor agreed to welcome Zarelli, it was typical that the club secretary went to meet him in person at the station. He even gave him a hand with his luggage.
Did give him a hand to carry his cases over the bridge and down to the Regency. I welcomed him as on behalf of the directors of Bangor City, and I hope he would have a good long stay in Bangor.
Zarelli was made welcome at the Regency Hotel, whose landlord was also Bangor City's director of entertainment. In small town Bangor, the Italian footballer soon made a big impression.
He's a typical Italian youngster, you know, he had all the gear, he had the shades on, he had, you know, the pattern, he had the accent. So I used to say to girls, oh, look, we've got a new Italian guy you can have, you know, footballer's wives job.
Well, a good looking young lad. I mean, he was very smart. According to a couple of girls that he met in the Octagon, he was a very good dancer.
He had good fashion sense, I can safely say that. He had a certain pair of jeans on one day, which he turned around and said they were €170. But they were all sliced across, so he had to wear another pair of jeans underneath to hide the holes in the jeans.
When the stars make you drool, just like a pastifazool, that's amore.
The club thought they were onto a winner. But there was one small flaw in this fashionable figure, a broken nose, which not only delayed his arrival, but also meant that when he did turn up, he couldn't even play.
The strange thing was, he came to this pre-season game, said he couldn't take part, then said he would take part. He took the nose bandage off to play football. Then when he sat down, back down on the bench again and put the nose bandage back on, which you think would be the other way around, why should he do that?
After all the anticipation and delay, what Peter Davenport finally saw on the pitch was disappointing.
He didn't look the part, to be honest. He didn't look good enough. You know, from what the sort of build-up had been, that, you know, we're going to get this sort of up-and-coming superstar from Italy. It just didn't, the players weren't impressed at all, and I wasn't impressed.
You're expecting something special. His football was comical, to be honest with you. Yeah, played like a Sunday league player and just had no skills about him for an Italian.
And the comedy followed Zarelli into the dressing room.
He was a bit over the top with what he was wearing. Like, when we got in the showers, he had like dressing gown on and stuff like that. He just looked funny.
Troubled by Zarelli's lack of playing skills, the club put in calls to the Welsh and Italian FAs to check out his CV. Meanwhile, back at the Regency, alarm bells were going off.
I took him to the doctors. He had a look at his nose. He says, there's nothing wrong with his nose. As far as I'm concerned, there's nothing been broken, hasn't been broken. His suspicions started growing then.
A disturbing new picture of Zarelli was emerging, of a footballer who couldn't or wouldn't play. Not only that, he was helping himself to things in the hotel.
He never asked for anything, he just took it, especially when I wasn't here. There's too many cameras here, so I knew exactly what he was up to, you know. When we counted all up at the end of the week, it was quite a substantial amount, plus his bed and breakfast. I think that came to about £600 or £700, which he owed me.
Although still not playing football, Zarelli continued to exploit his relationship with the club. He began to prey upon supporters, pressurising some for money.
He saw me outside Bank Cathedral, and I was going up to Witherspoon's for a Sunday lunch, and he followed me into Witherspoon's, and he asked me for a lend of an X amount of money, which I didn't have on me. And I made arrangements to go to the Regency to take this money to him, and he says, don't bring it there, I don't want Gwyn to know. That's the manager of the Regency. Anyway, I offered him a lower amount of money, which was £50 I gave him, which I never had back off him.
Just came out with a big sob story saying that he hadn't been paid from the Italian FA, and, you know, he was pulling the heartstrings and he burst out crying. And it was at that point I thought, well, I gave him £20.
He saw me about a month later, and he asked me that time for around £100, and I said, no, I can't give it to you, you know? In the end, he was pressurising me, you know, for money all the time, you know.
He'd run out of people to borrow money off. The odd pound was going missing in here, and caught him on camera just walking past the till. Twice I seen him just reaching out and catching a pound here or £2 I had.
Confronted, Zarelli turned on the tears.
If Alex never had an answer for anything, he would burst into tears. Off he would go, and he'd go, oh, you have been my best friend, and you have been my father, and he'd be rubbing his eyes, and the tears would run properly. In the end, I said, I don't believe you. You're a con man.
They'd reached the same conclusion at Bangor City Football Club.
He gave a CV which mentioned Sheffield Wednesday, Glasgow Rangers, Leeds United, and I phoned people at Sheffield Wednesday who were new, and they just had no record of him. They had no knowledge of him whatsoever.
If Zarelli's CV was false, Peter Davenport began to wonder how the faxes he'd received from the Italian FA could be genuine. He also began to wonder about Matteo Colabassi.
And it just so happened that I phoned Colabassi on this particular day, had a conversation about the whole setup. And 15 minutes later, I phoned Gwyn Williams, who was putting Alessandro Zarelli up. And Zarelli was with Gwyn Williams, and he passed the telephone over to him. And straight away, I thought, that's the same voice. That's the same voice as the guy I've just been speaking to.
They suspected Zarelli had two phones, one of which he used to answer calls as Colabassi. They decided to try and catch Zarelli out.
So we came up with this plan that I would ring Colabassi's phone and see if Zarelli's phone rang.
Sure enough, the telephone rings. Alex has picked the phone out of his pocket and he's walked into here, just by that window there, and he's talking away. And then he hangs up. So I phone Peter back. He says, yeah, I just got through to him. Did Alex answer the phone? He's going, yes. Well, I'm supposed to be talking to Calabresi here, he said.
Wasn't a coincidence. There was no other way it could be. It was one and the same guy.
Zarelli's game was up at Bangor City. He was asked to leave the club and the Regency Hotel. But he didn't leave Bangor. Instead, he simply moved up the road to new accommodation and put a fresh spin on his cover story. He was now a player on loan to Carnarvon, a club only 10 miles from Bangor. Although his story was fiction, Zarrelli still tried to exploit his imaginary status as a footballer.
He arrived here asking for accommodation, but he didn't intend paying me the rent. He was telling me that his club would pay the rent monthly, and I would have to wait for that, and they would pay it in arrears.
Zarrelli started to work behind the bar, but Michael was suspicious of his story and asked one of his regular customers, a former Bangor City goalie, to check Zarrelli out.
He said that he was actually on the books at Sheffield Wednesday, and then they'd loaned him out, which he was going to Ireland for the season, which, you know, Sheffield Wednesday had loaned him to Ireland, and then he'd come to Carnarvon on loan for the season, and then he was going to Scotland for the season, and then back to England for another season on loan, and then going back to Sheffield Wednesday, which to me is nearly 5 years on. To be on loan for five seasons, it doesn't add up anyway.
Michael decided it was time for Zarrelli to go.
His rent was due, I asked him for it, and he said, if you pay me my wages, I'll come back next week and give you your rent. I said, it doesn't work like that. I'll take your rent out of your wages. And then he just burst into tears. So I just said, I'm sorry, tears mean nothing to me at all.
Zarrelli moved on again and found a new bar job with accommodation. Bangor is a small town, and word soon got round where he was. Hearing he was earning money, Gwyn paid him a surprise visit. Zarrelli left town the very next day, travelling on borrowed money.
So landlords walked in and he said, I've just dropped Alex off in the station and I've just given him some money to travel. And I said, did he tell you this? Did he tell you that? Yes, he says, exactly. I said, well, he's conned you as well, hasn't he? And that was the last we've seen of Alex after that.
But Peter Davenport suspected the story was bigger than Bangor. He phoned journalist Jez Hemmings.
He said, find out what you can about Alessandro Zarrelli. He says there's something really fishy about this, and suggested I get in touch with Andy Thomas, who was the secretary of Lisbon Distillery Football Club in the Irish League. So I did that, and that's when the story really started to unfold.
Coming up after the break...
Who's Matteo Colavesi?
This summer, it's all about one sport.
It's an English game.
In summer 2005, Bangor City Football Club had welcomed Alessandro Zarrelli, hoping they'd found the next Italian superstar. But Zarrelli's impressive CV turned out to be as fictitious as his playing skills. It wasn't the first time a club had been conned in this way. In 1996, Southampton manager Graham Souness got a call purporting to be from World Footballer of the Year George Weah with a tip-off about a Senegalese player called Ali Dia.
He played with George Weah at Paris Saint-Germain, and last year he was playing in the second division in Germany. And we said, come down and train with us for a week or so and see what's what, so we're looking.
Dia claimed to have played for his country. In fact, he said he'd scored two goals for them days before this training session. With a CV like this and George Weah's apparent endorsement, no wonder Souness signed Ali Dia. He even played him in a Premiership match, once and once only, because even though Dia almost scored a goal, he tricked his way into the team. Ali Dia had conned Southampton. George Weah said he didn't know Ali Dia and hadn't phoned Souness, but Ali Dia stuck to his story.
He told me that George ring him and said that I'm a good player. I'm not afraid to tell that I'm a good player. I can prove that. I'm going to prove that.
So George Weah did ring Graham Souness?
Personally, like I told you, I don't really know.
He's a liar! He's a liar! He's a liar!
Before Southampton signed Ali Dia, he'd not been with Senegal, but with Blyth Spartans, a Tyneside club struggling in the lower leagues.
Next thing I knew, I was watching him on Match of the Day and watching him playing for Southampton, which was, you know, pretty unbelievable at the time.
Ali Dia was living the dream. For 43 minutes, he got to play in a Premiership game.
Still amazed, I think everybody's amazed that he got that far. Maybe Zarelli thought that, if Zarelli's his real name, that he could go that far, and maybe thought that he could do the same sort of thing.
Zarelli may have dreamt the same dream as Ali Dia, but his fantasy football career was speeding away from the Premiership. His next target, Connors Quay Nomads, a club just up the coast, but a long way down the league. This time, he'd picked a team who were really in trouble.
We were at the bottom of the league, we were rock bottom, and I get a phone call from a gentleman called Matteo Colabassi. And ironically, I thought it was a wind-up. I more or less told him, I says, I'm not in the mood. And the voice went dead at the other end, says, no, no, Mr. Hunter, I am Matteo Colabassi. I am from the Italian FA. I've got a centre-forward good in the air and scores plenty of goals. He has been with Sheffield Wednesday, Glasgow Rangers. And I said, look, at this moment of time, just send me a fax.
A fax arrived, almost identical to the one sent to Bangor. Signed by Matteo Colabassi, it offered a talented young player plus a cash sum for the club at the end of the season. Bobby Hunter couldn't believe his luck.
This is manna from heaven. If he could score goals for us, who knows? Put him on a contract, sky's the limit. If he was that good, he did develop, hence you can move on, transfer fees, click in, etc, etc. Yes.
Zarelli arrived and moved into the hotel the club had arranged for him. That's where Neville Powell first got a look at the player who was going to rescue his club from the bottom of the league. As ever, Zarelli talked a good game.
He just said that there were six players going to be sent to clubs all around Europe, and he was one of them, and our club's been picked. And I found it a bit strange that the Italian FA would want to send one of their better players to a team that's struggling in the Welsh Premier.
The Nomads soon realised their star player couldn't deliver what had been promised.
You can tell with the first touch if the lad's got it or hasn't got it.
He'll still Kalinichenko. Spartak Moscow.
Also, totally unrelated matter. He's a con man. And he apparently tried the same thing on with Koniski.
Zarelli got the boot again.
He burst into tears, more or less. He was calling Colabassi for everything. He was going to get his knife out and knife him. He was turning a bit nasty then, not towards myself, but he was the tears. He says, I have no money. He says, you give me £40. How do I get home? What would you do if you had a 21-year-old son? The heartstrings was beginning to pull with me at one point, and I'm saying, no, I'm certainly being conned here.
Connors Quay got off lightly. They rumbled Zarelli in less than a week.
We, I would say, were very lucky. The final bill was, I think it was £196. Call it £200. That was including the evening meal, bar. He'd a bottle of Italian beer.
At this point, Zarelli disappeared, leaving behind a trail of debts, a lot of questions, and a journalist determined to get some answers.
As soon as he left Connors Quay, there was just, he disappeared. He just disappeared without a trace. I had several leads. There was links to the southwest. I know he'd also tried other clubs as well. He'd had a go at TNS, who are, if you like, they're the Chelsea of the Welsh Premier. They gave us a link to the southwest, and still we couldn't get hold of him.
Then Jez discovered that before arriving in Wales, Zarelli had played in Northern Ireland. In January 2005, Zarelli had signed to Lisbon Distillery. The signing made headlines. By June, he'd been sacked, as Jez discovered when he spoke to club secretary Andy Thompson.
I felt quite angry when I came off the phone from Andy, because it seemed like someone that works at the club, you know, for the love of it, not for any financial reward, had tried to do his club a good turn and had been really quite nastily turned over.
Distillery are one of the oldest clubs in Northern Ireland. Once great, but now struggling. When they signed a new Italian player, it was big news.
When Mr. Alessandro Zarelli arrived at Lisburn Distillery, everyone was very excited. He arrived at the club with a CV stating that he'd played for Rangers, Sheffield Wednesday and Leeds. So I think the Lisburn Distillery people were sort of taken aback by this. It was almost as if they'd hit the jackpot.
The place was buzzing when they heard, obviously, the news, first of all, that we were going to sign an Italian. We heard about his past, the previous clubs he was at. Once the players and the supporters heard about this, everyone was, you know, very excited at the possibility of a player of this quality coming to Lisburn Distillery.
You know, he's going to bring a bit of continental class to the team, you know, and who knows what he'll deliver. Could he take them back to Europe? Could he even get them challenging for a championship? Is this guy going to be the next Del Piero? Is this guy going to be the next Zola? Everyone was thinking, my goodness, we've found a superstar.
Interviewed on local TV, Zarelli seemed as much in love with the club as they already were with him.
Sì, un buon club, penso che il manager sia anche un manager importante, molto capace, diciamo.
Do you not mind him saying that you're fat?
The manager went and picked him up personally at the airport, greeted him there, brought him down to the club, all the boys gave him a great welcome. Everyone was surprised on his arrival. We're expecting a physical, 6 foot plus player, quite strong. But when he arrived, he was completely opposite. Maybe 5 foot six, quite slight build. But then the players thought, well, it must be a few silky skills, must be, you know, quite a ball player.
At first, as in Wales, Zarelli charmed everyone, even flirting with the local TV presenter.
Penso che la situazione sia anche qui buona e penso comunque che Claire McClellan sia comunque una cosa buona. Ciao.
I'm liking that boy.
Distillery began to realise Zarelli was not all he claimed to be.
I think after maybe the bedding in period, as it was, 3 or 4 weeks, and he didn't really seem to be coming on any, improving, maybe even going backwards, you know. But I think the players started to ask questions, and I think the manager knew, you know, in his heart that he wasn't going to do the job that he thought he would do.
He wasn't good, let's be honest about it. He wasn't good at all. But because Distillery were so excited by the fact that they could have some Italian superstar on their books, they decided to keep him going, and they made all these allowances for him. They were basically saying, oh, he's taking time to adjust, you know, maybe it's the climate, you know, maybe he's missing his family. But it was none of these. The fact was, he was just a terrible footballer.
He didn't train the first couple of sessions because he said he had a bit of a knee injury. And then he did train. And I remember Darren Armour hitting him in a tackle, which was typical Darren style. And he went down to the ground and he slapped the ground, he rolled it about. And we've seen all this Italian stuff coming out, you know.
But then came the match, his first match for Distillery against Finn Harps. And that was it for the players. They just couldn't believe what was going on. They were laughing at his ability or his lack of it. He couldn't control the ball. He couldn't pass the ball. He basically couldn't do anything that any footballer with any sort of basic skill could do.
I said to the reserve, I never got to the game that night, but I said to the reserve team manager, what was he like? And he says, he's brutal. And
brutally bad.
Brutally bad, brutally bad, he says, you know.
It was as if the Italian stallion that that brought into the club had become a donkey right before their very eyes.
Zarelli was kicked out of Lisburn, but the club hadn't heard the last of him. It seemed that he'd spent his time there planning his next move.
The next phone bill that the Lisburn Distillery secretary received, he looked at it in disbelief and despair because it was the highest phone bill he'd ever had in his life. It was just a crazy bill, crazy numbers. And it transpired that Zarelli had actually been phoning clubs in England, Scotland and Wales, obviously using the secretary's phone. He'd also be making calls to Australia and Italy, and he'd also been charging up an internet bill, which was just unbelievable. Distillery were caught out, but it could have been a lot worse for them. You know, I think they do see it as pretty embarrassing. They could have given him a big contract. They could have given him lots of money, a huge signing on fee. Goodness knows, it could have bankrupted the football club.
For the clubs, and I think this has been a wake-up call,
because it was so easy for him to get in. I think there's a lot of people who are less trustful of others now, and it's taken a little bit of the nice element out of the league. I think people are a bit more suspicious about incomers to the league now.
We know that after Northern Ireland, Zorelli conned his way through Wales and then disappeared. Trying to figure out where he might be now, we followed the fax trail and headed to Italy to find out more about the man the newspapers were calling Signor Con. We travelled to Zorelli's hometown just outside Turin, but even here, we found as much fiction as fact. This is the headquarters of the Italian FA in Turin, number 3, Via Alessandro Volta, which is the address on the faxes the British clubs received. But when we dialed the telephone number beneath the address, it rang here, Rivoli, in the home of Zorelli's mum and dad. The faxes had been sent from here, a small electrical shop near Zorelli's home, which offered a public fax service. And then, at last, we found one thing that was true, the local club where Zorelli said he'd played. But even here, when we spoke to officials at the club, we heard stories and names that sounded strangely familiar.
Ma è arrivato in maniera un po' strana, non si è presentato.
He arrived in a peculiar way. Other players just come and introduce themselves, but he come after a phone call from a so-called official from the Italian FA, someone who looked after Italians who played abroad.
Con le federazioni estere, e in questo caso, adesso non mi viene molto.
I can't remember his name, Cola something.
O con la base, ecco, non qualcosa, esatto, forse con la base, in ogni modo mi
pare. That's it, con la base. Con la base said there was a young man just arrived from playing the youth league in England. Although he came from Rivoli, he would appreciate it if he could play for our club.
Parlava dalle giovanili dell'Inghilterra, anche se era di Rivoli, e che avrebbero avuto piacere che potesse giocare o provare nella nostra società.
Zorelli played with Cascina Vica in autumn 2004, just before he appeared in Northern Ireland. It's an amateur club where locals play for the fun of it. Even though he was a hometown boy, Zorelli didn't fit in with the squad and his football skills didn't impress.
Il primo impatto non è stato dei più felici, perché Alessandro aveva dei grossi problemi a inserirsi nella squadra, un po' caratterialmente.
He didn't make a great first impression. Alessandro found it very difficult to fit in with the team. A bit because of his closed-up character and a bit because of the way he played. I thought it was because he had just come from England and the English game is more physical and less technical. I thought it would just take time to adjust. But after a few weeks, I realized that there wasn't the problem.
The club was surprised when they began to receive inquiries about their new player from Triestina, a team in Italy's second division.
Experience. Qualcosina ha fatto qui. Sono arrivate alcune telefonate.
For a while we received phone calls and faxes from professional clubs asking if Zorelli was going to play that afternoon.
E sostanzialmente ci abbiamo riso sopra proprio perché ci sembrava abbastanza improbabile.
We just laughed about it, knowing it was improbable that a professional club would phone asking when and where a certain player would play.
Ma oggi dove giocate, con chi giocate?
In this case, Zorelli.
Il tal giocatore, in questo caso Zorelli.
Dopo tutte queste telefonate da parte della Triestina, ci è venuto il sospetto che c'era qualcosa che non.
After many phone calls from Triestina, we became suspicious. We knew the sporting director of the club, so we phoned him to ask if the calls were real. He told us they had never dreamt of coming to see someone on our team. He said if someone was using their name without permission, they would sue.
Che non si sono mai sognati di venire a vedere qualcuno della.
I think he's a bit of a Walter Mitty character. I think he believes that he's good enough to play football for any team he wants to. But he's also a con man, and that's my main thing that I'm interested in. I don't want him to do it anywhere else. He's apparently taking a lot of money off people in Bangor, which is upsets me, because the good, genuine people who are taken in by him, and they wanted to basically look after him because he was part of Bangor City.
If Alessandro Zarelli had chosen a club like Manchester United or Chelsea, and he'd have done his tricks over there, I think, you know, like the guy who jumped into all the Man United photographs at the European Cup final, you know, I think most of us probably would have said, well done, you're living the dream, you know. Not right as it is to con people that way. But with bigger clubs that could afford it, maybe, you know, there'd be a certain amount of grudging admiration for him. I think the fact that he took clubs and people associated with clubs who are not affluent, who do it for the love of the game, who put a lot of their own time in, and you know, are genuinely good people, I think it's left a bitter taste with a lot of people, and rightly so.
All you can say is that he's going to try it again. He's definitely going to try it again. And if this alleged people that he's there and he's going to try it, well, maybe they can do something about it.
In part three, we track down and turn the tables on Senior Con. Throughout 2005, a young player called Alessandro Zarelli tricked his way into football clubs in Wales and Northern Ireland.
Well, as you can see from the picture, he's your stereotypical smooth Italian, good-looking guy. Very good with the chat, by all accounts. Very popular with the ladies. That was certainly, he was a hit with the ladies. All in all, I think he's everything that you would want from your smooth Italian conman.
We discovered that Zarelli was now trying his luck with the Scottish clubs. Familiar faxes started to appear with all too familiar promises. The time had come to flush Zarelli out. We found out that he was in the UK, somewhere in the Bishop Stortford area, but knew that the key to finding him was in his hometown in Italy. We travelled to Rivoli and discovered that the faxes were being sent from a small electrical shop around the corner from Zarelli's parents' home. When we phoned the number on the faxes, Zarelli's mother answered. Back in the UK, journalist Jez Hemmings agreed to pose as a football agent keen to sign young players. He phoned the number in Rivoli. That night, Zarelli called him. Then an email arrived, signed, like the faxes, by Italian FA official Matteo Colabassi. It stated Zarelli was under contract at Sheffield Wednesday, but on loan to MK Dons. Nevertheless, Zarelli agreed to meet our fake agent and discuss his footballing future.
Strange, I've seen that face before. See him hanging round my door.
We set up a meeting at a London hotel and rigged the room with three hidden cameras to record what happened. Our fake agent was in place, along with a young footballer of our own. The only question was, would Zarelli show?
Well, we're just wrapping up now, so you can bring him up if you like. Right. Game on. Alessandro, yeah. Take a seat over there, and I'm just seeing this man for the stairs, okay, my friend? All right.
Under the pretext of seeing his previous client out, Jez leaves Zarelli alone in the room. Sure enough, he takes a quick look at the agent's documents.
How you doing? Hey. You okay?
All right.
How's your journey, all right?
Yeah, all right.
You're very keen.
Yeah,
how you doing? You're right.
I've been in Milton Keynes this morning.
Sorry?
I've been in Milton Keynes this morning at the training ground because I had some treatment.
What you been? What you say? Tell me about you've been training this morning.
I had some treatment. Yeah, I had some treatment from the injury.
His story is already sounding familiar.
Who's paying you at the moment? Is it Sheffield Wednesday?
Yeah.
You're with Sheffield Wednesday, yeah? So your actual contract is with Sheffield Wednesday, and
yeah,
that ends end of June?
Yeah.
Yeah?
I had a chat with them, and I talked with them about the chance to get free and let the contract expire before the end of June, and they told me that the chance can be about the half of June, but not before.
And you're on loan now at?
MK Dons.
MK Dons. So when did you come down to the Dons?
This season.
Okay, so you've been there since the start of the season.
And I really didn't enjoy my time there. I really didn't like that.
Bear with me 1 second. I'll put the notes on.
But before Sheffield Wednesday Yacht Academy, I came here in July 2001 and stayed in Glasgow Rangers Yacht Academy.
How long were you with them for?
1 year.
And do you like Rangers? And do you like Glasgow?
Yeah, they're still my favourite.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Right, just a couple of notes I made. Matteo Colabesi.
Yeah.
Now, I'm right in saying, we discussed him, didn't we? He's not actually, you've not actually got a contract with Matteo. Just explain the relationship with him.
No, he's a particular friend, you know. He's a very, very, very good friend, a person that I trust absolutely, 100%, mm-hmm, because he's the yacht chief executive of the Italian FA.
Okay.
And he helped me when I was younger, you know, not that I'm old, but, mm-hmm, you know, when I was 16 years old, he helped me to have that trial at Rangers.
Okay.
And, you know, he took care of myself every time, you know, even when he was not my...
So it's not so much a formal arrangement you've got with him, it's more he's helping you out.
Yeah, yeah, he's, you know, he's as a second father or a second brother, you know.
That's fine. Tell me about your clubs. Where did you start?
I just started when I was 6 years old, I started with my local team, you know.
Is that near Turin, is it?
Yeah. And I stayed with them since 6 years old until 14.
Oh, right, okay.
And after that, I had 3 years in FC Valenzana, that is like your League Two.
Okay, from Valenzana, where next?
Rangers.
So it's straight across to Rangers?
Yes, Rangers.
And what made you come across the Rangers?
I always have appreciated the English football, you know.
Okay.
That's why I asked Mr. Colabase to try to organize me, to arrange me at our cost, a trial at Rangers.
Yeah. So what happened to Rangers then?
The contract was just 1 year.
Okay. So they didn't non-renew the contract?
No.
Okay.
And I moved to Sheffield Wednesday, mm-hmm, with the help of Matteo Colabase as well, because he proposed myself to Sheffield Wednesday. I stayed a month at Sheffield Wednesday on trial.
Yeah.
And then started with Sheffield Wednesday.
So you've been with Sheffield Wednesday ever since, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. And why is this contract expiring? Is it just the end of the contract? You can't get a new one? Is that the end of it, yeah?
I think it's the end of it, you know. As every...
Do you want to stay?
I'd like to change, honestly.
Yeah. Did you go on loan anywhere else while you were at Sheffield?
No.
Right, okay. So.
Which will be news to three teams at least.
That pretty much covers the sort of things I wanted to know then, I think.
Satisfied?
Mm-hmm. Have you got any references that you could get for me?
Matteo Colabase.
So Matteo Colabase?
Can get you everything that you want.
Okay. How do your family know about Matteo Colabase? How did you meet him? Was it through the Italian, or was he a family friend, did you say?
No, he's a family friend as well.
Okay, sorry.
That's why I have a close relationship with him and my dad and my brother. My brother has been a professional player.
Oh, really?
For all his career. He played for AC Torino.
Yeah.
He was a goalkeeper.
Oh, right.
He's 11 years older than me.
Right.
So now he's...
So it's like following in the family footsteps,
yeah.
How do you feel about being away from home and being in the UK?
You know, staying here in UK was all that I ever dreamed, you know. Yeah. Because I just asked when I was 16 years old, Matteo, to try to arrange me something to come here, and now I don't want to go back, you know.
What do your parents think about it all?
My father, he's not, you know, he's happy because, you know, in family he had two sons, and both of them are playing football.
So they're doing well, yeah.
He played football, my brother, and I'm playing football. So he's happy, but, you know, I think in my heart he preferred that I was in Italy playing football.
If you were going to be liking yourself to a player, who would you liken yourself to?
Don't know, you know, I like myself.
What sort of style would you say?
Don't know. I like Joe Cole, you know, I like...
Yeah?
I like him, yeah.
Yeah, you like the more creative?
Yeah.
Okay, just bear with me a second, let me just go on back to...
We decide we've heard enough. The time's come to confront Zarelli.
Hi, Alessandro.
Hi.
I'm going to talk to you now. I think you have been telling enough lies now, and I think you need to start telling the truth. I think there's a lot of people in Bangor and in Lisbon Distillery and in Connors Quay who would like to hear the truth from you. And we're making a documentary for Sky Television about you. I've got a film crew with me.
Yeah.
I would like you to give us an interview to explain, to tell us your story. We phoned Sheffield Wednesday, and they've never heard of you.
Yeah, no, I stayed on trial at Sheffield Wednesday, that was true.
But you just told David that you were under contract. You are still under contract with Sheffield Wednesday. We phoned them yesterday, and no one there has ever heard of you. We phoned the academy, we phoned the club, we phoned everybody there. I mean, are you under contract to Sheffield Wednesday or not?
No.
You're not. Can you explain to us why you've been lying about it?
Yeah, I always wanted to play football better.
But why have you done it this way?
You know, it was a mistake that I did. Absolutely a mistake that I did.
But did you not think you'd get found out?
Yeah, but it was a close, you know, everything was finished, you know. If they weren't calling me, nobody, you know, it was closed. I wasn't playing for nobody at the moment, so the speech was closed.
So is that why you came to England?
No, I'm just working now as well, so I'm doing my life, you know, normally.
But it's not normal to tell the kind of lies that you've been telling in order to try and get a football position.
I know, but that's it, you know, it's finished, it's over.
But who's Matteo Colavesi?
Doesn't exist.
You just made him up.
Yeah.
So the number, if I phone that number that you gave David for Matteo Colavesi, who answers the phone?
Nobody.
That phone?
No.
So what happens when people phone that number? Because you said to David, phone, if you...
But the number doesn't exist.
It doesn't exist.
No. Now, I'm gonna.
What do you?
Gonna
what
close.
Do you?
No, I'm gonna close now. The interview.
Okay. If you want to talk, you can phone that number that you have for David, and I will answer it. Okay.
Throughout the world, I'll guarantee you, over the next 10, 20, 30 years, there will be people caught out, because we will always have people who are trying to make it as a footballer, even if they don't have the talent to do so.
The next day, Zarelli did call and left this message.
I want to thank you for the big spot that you made for me, and thank you for everything, because now people know me. Thanks a lot. You're a big son of a bitch.
End of message. Tomorrow at 10 on Sky One, John Cleese sets out to understand the finer points of the beautiful game, examining the good, the bad and the funny as he uncovers the art of football. Here on Sky 2, catch up with 24 next before the finale this weekend on Sky One.